Welcome to this service of Holy Communion. My name is Debbie Pang and I'm part of the clergy team at St Mary's Charlcombe and St Stephen's Lansdowne. And it's wonderful to be able to welcome you into my home as you sit in yours. We may be separated by space and time, but we remember that we are together in spirit. We remember too that God is both inside and outside of space and time. And therefore, if you'd like to have some bread and some wine with you to be able to take and share at that appropriate time in the service, as though we were together, which we are in spirit, then you're very welcome to do that. Of course, you may not feel comfortable with that, in which case do remember that I am taking communion on behalf of all in the Benefice. This is a time of great transition. Not only are we coming out of lockdown and exploring how we do that safely, of which there'll be a little bit more about that in our churches later, but it's also a big time of transition within our churches. Last Sunday, we welcomed Andrew. Many of us watched as he was licensed as a lay worker in our Benefice. Of course, he should have been being ordained deacon, and we're hopeful that that will happen in September. But he was licensed last week and able to start his curacy with us nevertheless. So there was great excitement last Sunday morning. And then last Sunday evening, the sad news broke that Richard Brook, who had been he'd been a reader in our Benefice for many years, sadly died. And so at this time we hold that transition, that tension. It's as if the baton has been passed from one to the other. We hold the excitement and we hold the sadness. Richard led an extraordinary life, encompassing mountaineering, polar exploration, as well as ministry in our Benefice. He had many friends and he will be sorely missed. Our thoughts and our prayers are with Valerie and with their sons, Patrick and David. And so it's fitting to have a little time of quiet, of silence, to remember Richard, being grateful for the way that he touched our lives, and remembering Valerie and his family. Some words from scripture. At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants." Friends, we meet in the name of God, who's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let's pray together our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our advocate in heaven, to bring us to eternal life and to save us from all that leads us away from God's love. These things we call our sins. And so we come to God now in penitence and faith, bringing before him all those things for which we're sorry, for ourselves and for the world. Have a moment just to bring those to mind now. We come firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live and love in peace with all. So we pray together. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. So, Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's say the Gloria together as forgiven people. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. You have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And a prayer for today, the fourth Sunday of Trinity. Lord of heaven and earth, whose Son came eating and drinking, exposing the rivalry that tears the world apart, may we share his feast and friendship and lay our burdens in his liberating arms, through Jesus Christ, wisdom's child. Amen. Our first reading is going to be read for us today by Sue Sloman from St Mary's Church. You might notice the broad grin on Sue's face as she begins to read, knowing that she had just received the news that her daughter had given birth to a son, Beverly's first child, a son, a little boy, Zachary. So congratulations to Beverly and Matt, and to Sue for being a grandmother again. But let's put that to one side for a moment and listen to Sue as she reads.
The reading is taken from Psalm 145, verses 8 to 15. The Lord is gracious and merciful, long-suffering and of great goodness. The Lord is loving unto every man, and his mercy is over all his works. All thy works praise thee, O Lord, and thy saints give thanks unto thee. They show the glory of thy kingdom and talk of thy power, that thy power, thy glory, and mightiness of thy kingdom might be known unto men. Thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and thy dominion endureth throughout all ages. The Lord upholdeth all such as fall, and lifteth up all those that are down. The eyes of all wait upon thee, O Lord, and thou givest them their meat in due season. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Sue. Now, this week really is a week of many significant milestones for people within our churches. Malcolm Buchan from St Stephen's Church is about to read our gospel for us. Malcolm celebrated his 90th birthday yesterday. So congratulations, Malcolm, and hope you had a fantastic birthday. You might like to stand as Malcolm reads.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord.
But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows and saying, We have piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, He hath a devil. And the Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, Behold a man gluttonous and a wine-bibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. And wisdom is justified of her children. At that time Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whom whoever the Son will reveal him. Come unto me, all ye that labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Here endeth the lesson.
Thank you, Malcolm. Now, it's wonderful to be able to welcome Andrew Avramenko and to introduce him to preach to us for the first time. But before Andrew preaches, I'd just love to take a moment to pray for him. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Andrew and for his family, for Elaine, Josh and Abigail. Lord, we thank you for the call that you've placed on his life and for bringing him to join us in our benefice. We thank you for the message that you've given him for today. We pray that as he speaks, you'd use his words and speak clearly to us in our hearts. In Jesus' name we ask this. Amen.
Hello. Here I am. My curacy with you has finally started. Back in September last year, when it was announced that I would be joining you, I don't think any of us expected it to be quite like this, with my ordination training completed, but with me not yet ordained. Last week I was licensed as a lay worker, a lay curate in effect, so that I could start my curacy with you. I have my stoles behind me, but I cannot yet wear them. But if you will bear with me, I will wear this, for I am your deacon to be. Hopefully in September I will be ordained and I will walk out of Wells Cathedral with the white stole behind me. But in these uncertain times, we cannot be sure. We can but pray. And here we are, either side of a screen. You can see me, but alas, I cannot see you. The screen is like a one-way mirror, which isn't unusual for me. I helped pay my way through university by standing behind a one-way mirror as a police ID parade model. But that's a story for another day. Thanks to a Zoom meeting last Sunday, I can picture some of you, but I do not properly know you yet. Many of you remain an even bigger mystery, whether you're a member of St. Mary's, St. Stephen's, or watching from further afield. Whichever of those groups you belong to, whichever those communities, I am glad that you are here and watching and worshipping with us. But things wouldn't be much different if we had begun this curacy physically rather than digitally. We would still be doing the dance of getting to know each other. We would be wondering what each other is like, what each one of us really thinks. We might be wondering how to act before one another and what to say to give a good impression. But even when we have known each other for a long time, we may still be wondering what to say and how to say it. We might still be trying to understand and to be understood. So what is a person to do? When we are with people, we may try and predict what we think they might want us to say or to do, or we may just do what we want. Both are problematic. If we try to please some of the people, we might do so at the expense of others. If we do whatever we want without thinking of those we're with, we might please some people. We might be lucky and please everyone. But we might please no one, and worse still, alienate and drive people away. Our gospel reading today speaks into such situations. Situations when we can find ourselves thinking, no matter what I do, I just can't win. First, Jesus describes people playing music for people to dance to, but no one dances. Then he describes people singing laments, of which no one takes any notice. Two examples of people unimpressed by what others do for them and wanting something else. And in case the people listening don't get it, he sharpens the focus and pinpoints the problem. People didn't see or understand what was being said because they were expecting something different. John the Baptist came as simply as he could, stripped of society's niceties, so that his message was clear and easy to grasp. But because he was acting so differently from everyone else and saying things that no one else was saying, they couldn't understand or relate to him. They knew they were okay, clever, sensible, so John couldn't be. To them, the clear message he was giving was not clear. It made no sense. To them, he sounded like a demon-possessed stranger babbling away and speaking nonsense. Jesus was little different. He went against expected behaviour by befriending tax collectors and sinners. What sane person would do that? Surely someone who ate and drank with these people must be drunk, a desperate addict in need of alcohol and food. Surely someone who went so far away from society's norms must be ignorant and stupid. Suspicion abounded. John abstained from food and drink, and people thought he was crazy. Jesus did the opposite, and people thought he was crazy too. They simply couldn't get their head around two people who were living and speaking differently from what they expected. It's almost as if John and Jesus would try whatever they would try, just wouldn't get them understood or be given time. We don't always see what is happening either. Sometimes we see what we expect to see, hear what we expect to hear. Sometimes we are so accustomed to our situation that anything at odds with it doesn't register. It's not that we are ignorant or unintelligent, but the comfort we gain from living within what we know can drown out the unknown and the unexpected. So how do we overcome this problem? How do we see what we don't see? How do we know what we don't know? The answer, as every Sunday school child knows, is Jesus. But it's more than that. The answer is Jesus and the child. Jesus sets a bar and leads by example. We can do no better than look to him. But when we do, we still see through the lenses of our own eyes that are full of assumptions and expectations. Children show the way in the open simplicity that they approach the world. Freed from years of experience and memories, they look upon new things with open minds. They know that they don't know, so they open their minds to new experiences without too many preconceptions, assumptions, and expectations. Or they look to people who they think do know and change their behaviour accordingly. Children aren't, for example, born racist, but if they see adults who are, they can be affected and become them like that themselves. Children don't naturally discriminate. They offer their love to all and hope that it is accepted. Children are open to it, see it, get it. Sometimes adults too often are closed to it, don't see it, don't get it. It is wisdom, revealed to those who, as Jesus encourages, approach life with a childlike simplicity and openness. People who don't assume or expect, but take people for who they are. People who see others not as they want to see them, but as God sees them. But God knows that this isn't easy. It isn't easy to unlearn what we have learned. I certainly found that during my ordination training. And as the people around Jesus and John found out, seeing and hearing something new, something different, can be difficult and uncomfortable. And we can so easily resist and react against it. even if we can lower our defences, if we can open ourselves to the point of view of another, it can be difficult to know how to handle what we hear. I have regularly found myself wrestling with conflicting truths, wondering what to do, to say, or to think. It can be debilitating. This is why Jesus urges us to turn to him, not only to see how to live, but for the strength to live that way too. We do that when we approach Jesus and when we live like a child would. When we look to the source of wisdom, we will learn to be wise like children learn. None of this means that we should always take the middle ground, a compromise of taking something from two extremes. None of this means saying or doing something that both ends of the spectrum will find impossible to accept. None of this means saying or doing anything we want without thought or care for the other. No, what this means is that we often find out what to do when we cast aside our assumptions and expectations and simply ask, what would Jesus do? Jesus provides the model for where to focus and how to act. If we approach things looking through his eyes, we will, bit by bit, see and understand things as he does. If we approach things with a childlike openness and turn trustingly towards God, the source of all wisdom, we will know what to say and what to do. And the answer will be as simple and as challenging as the two most important commandments, to love God and to love each other as we love ourselves. I am so excited to be with you, to do this act of loving each other and loving the other together. I'm looking forward to sharing these years with you and to get to know you and to learn with you. Amen.
Thank you, Andrew. As we reflect on Andrew's words, let's declare our faith in God with childlike hearts. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our prayers of intercession are going to be led for us today by Mike King from St. Stephen's Church.
This week it seems particularly appropriate for our prayers to come to this special place in the heart of Richard Brook, special also to us, the quiet garden here in Charlcombe. So loving God, we come to you now in prayer, having made a space in our lives to pause and reflect. We come to listen for your word, to ponder what you have to say to us. We come to hear your voice and to receive your guidance. Open our eyes to your presence, our hearts to your love, and our minds to your will. Direct our thoughts, enlarge our understanding, and shape our lives so that we may live and work for you to the glory of your name. Gracious God, we pray for peace, justice, and reconciliation throughout the world. We pray for the honouring of human rights and for the relief of the oppressed. We pray for places of conflict, those known to us personally or through the media, and those unknown, where dispute, unrest, injustice, suffering and fear are a part of daily life. We give thanks for all that is gracious in the lives of men, women and children, and pray your blessing on the work of peacekeepers, aid agencies and charities such as Send a Cow, Challenge Africa and Step UK. We pray for the renewal of the Church in faith, love and service. We pray for our bishops, priests, readers and all who serve you, and for the life of this benefice and community, particularly at this time as we consider the opportunities of increased reopening of our buildings. We give thanks for the continued worship and ministry with which we have been blessed, in spite of the difficulties and restrictions of this time that we journey through together. And we pray we may always be mindful that faith is lived out in our daily lives, outside of our buildings, and through our service to and fellowship with all people. We pray that you would fill us with the vision to see where the barren parts of our church and community life might bear fruit, refreshing and renewing our efforts with your Spirit, and gifting us with the skills that nurture new growth, giving life, love, and hope to those we seek to serve. We pray that in all our relationships, you will make us effective channels of your love and forgiveness, so that in all our thoughts, words, and actions, we are always in touch with God's renewing power. We pray for our local community, for all who live or work in it. We pray for the young and the elderly, for families, and at this time especially, all who are alone. We give thanks for the wonders of your creation, as well as the blessings of human skill and creativity, and all that reveals your glory. We remember our local schools finishing or preparing to finish this most unusual of terms soon. For the staff, pupils, governors and parents at St. Stephen's, Abbot Alphage, Kingswood, the Royal High and St. Mark's. We think particularly of those who are leaving at the end of this academic year, be it pupils or staff, and ask for your guidance and reassurance at this time of uncertainty and change for them. And we pray for those who are in need, for the sick, the sorrowful, and the bereaved. We pray for all who bring comfort, care, and healing. And we continue to give thanks and pray for all those who work in our hospitals, care homes and hospices, and those who care for us in the community. At this time we bring before you and pray for Muriel, Sally, Jean, Rebecca, Emily, Amelia, Oscar, and their families and friends, and all who look after them in their need. And in a moment of silence, we offer up to you those known to us, whose names are on our hearts. And we remember those who have come to the end of their earthly lives, asking for your mercy on them. For Richard, Jess, Sue and Des. May they, placing their faith in the God of life, share in the light and joy of heaven forever. And we ask for your comfort for those who are living with the loss of grief, thinking particularly of Valerie, Patrick and David. and a prayer for ourselves. Heavenly Father, in every age you have raised up holy men and women to reflect the light of Christ and to teach us the way of holiness. We thank you for your call to discipleship, fellowship and service, to sharing as your people in the work of your kingdom. We thank you that you call us as we are, with all our faults, weaknesses and doubts, accepting us not through our own deserving, but through your grace, your love and your mercy. We thank you for the inner presence of your Holy Spirit, through which Christ is constantly at work within us, moving deep within to change our lives and draw us ever closer to you. Loving God, receive our praise in his name. Help us to hear your voice clearly, to accept your will humbly, and to gladly respond to it in faith, ready to follow where you may lead, working for the growth of your kingdom and the glory of your name. And so we offer up these prayers in the name of Christ and commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Amen.
Thank you, Mike. So peace to you from God, our Creator. Peace from Jesus Christ, who is our peace. Peace from the Holy Spirit, the life giver. The peace of the triune God be always with you. Our first hymn has been chosen for us by Brenda Floyd. Brenda's part of our congregation at St Mary's Church. She's chosen a hymn that's often considered to be an evening hymn, or is often sung at funerals, but has some of the most wonderful words, very appropriate to Andrew's sermon and as we come to our time of communion. So let's sing together, Abide With Me.
Thank you.
holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, give us the bread of everlasting life and make us branches of the true vine. Blessed be God forever. Friends, the Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Ever-loving God, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us, announcing your kingdom is near. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup of wine. He gave thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. So, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and this one cup, so that we, in the company of St. Mary, St. Stephen and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Heavenly Father, forever and ever. Amen. So being made one in communion with God, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died and now lives for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Let's pray. Eternal God, comfort of the afflicted and healer of the broken, you have fed us at the table of life and hope. Teach us the ways of gentleness and peace, that all the world may acknowledge the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we pray together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gates of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights, give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the blessing. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and the rain fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may you know yourself held in the palm of God's kindly hand. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and those you love, now and always. Amen. Before we come to our final hymn, just a few short notices. Firstly, to remind you that Scruffy Church TV is also available on our website and is still being enjoyed by huge numbers of children and families. So if you know of someone who hasn't yet tuned in to Scruffy Church TV, do tell them about it. I mentioned earlier our transition time as we are looking at the church possibly reopening. We can reopen full services from now, but they have to be with no singing and we can't share communion. We're also mindful that many in our congregations are over 70 and many are vulnerable. So we're looking at the best way to move forward safely and for the benefit of as many people as possible. So there will be notices in the future coming out about what we will be doing. And please bear with us as we seek the best way forward at this time. Do pray for us in these decisions. And finally, I'm sure many will want to know details about Richard Brooks' funeral. We're still in a time when we have to have very limited numbers, but we will find a way of including as many people as possible. And again, information will come out as it is available. In the meantime, our prayers with Valerie and the family. We've come to time for our second hymn now. I thought it only right to ask Andrew to choose a hymn as it's his first Sunday with us. He's chosen the wonderful hymn, Be Thou My Vision. So let's sing together. Be with you next week. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Have a great week.